I'm going to read from Psalms 10, something my wife and I, prayed today. We declare, you know, when you declare and decree something, when you open your mouth, not in your spirit, but when you declare something with your mouth, it's spiritual seed that gets sent forth. And we know that God says that his word does not return to him void. Amen. The scriptures tells us that. His word will never return to him void. So when we declare, decree things, it's spiritual seed that is being sent out, getting planted, and it's going to prosper what it was set out to do. So today, so my wife and I just were reading Psalms 10, and we were declaring and decreeing Psalms 10. So I'm going to read it with you today, and you can follow along with me. I'm going to read from the New King James Version. It says, now this is a song of, it's a song. So it's a song of confidence in God's triumph over evil. Okay, we see a lot of things that are in the earth today that look, that are very evil, but God's going to triumph over them. Evil will never triumph. The Bible does tell us that evil will thrive, and we'll see evil men thrive, and we'll see all these types of things happening. But in the end, God's triumph, he will overtake and overcome evil. So we don't lose heart. And Peter tells us, don't be overwhelmed that these things have befallen us, right? Because when we're in Christ, trials and tribulations are going to come. So don't be overtaken by what we're seeing. It's part of the process, right? Jesus called a lot of these things birth pangs, right? But the end is not near. These are the precursor to the things that are going to come. But those who are in Christ are safe and secure from all alarm. And so that's what the old song tells us, right? Leaning on the everlasting arms. So God will triumph over evil. And we know that we do not wrestle with flesh and blood, but with what? Principalities, powers of darkness, right? Wickedness in high places. And so we're not wrestling with the flesh. We're wrestling with demonic things. So that's why we have to be alert. The Bible tells us to be sober, be vigilant, right? Because the enemy, the devil, Satan, goes about like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. The Bible says that we're to understand the wiles of the devil. And that word wiles mean methodical. The devil is methodical. He's methodical about the things he does. He's like that. You ever see the Wild Kingdom shows where the the animals are drinking by the water, and you see the alligator lurking, right? You see his eyes over the water, and he's moving real slow, right? He's moving real slow, and boom, right? The devil's slow about the things he does, and he gets you thinking that it's okay to drink that water, but you know, he's the devil's coming up, creeping up like a methodical beast, and he gets you if you're not paying attention, you know. So we have to be careful of that. So, but God will overcome, right? The Bible says that we're more than conquerors. We're super victorious. So in verse 1 in Psalms 10, it says, why do you stand afar off, O Lord? Doesn't it feel like that? Doesn't it feel like God's standing afar off when all this stuff is going on? Lord, why are you like, you know, everybody said, well, if God is such a loving God, why does all this happen? You know why all this happened? It's because of the sinful hearts and wickedness of people. It is a society and a generation that says, we don't need God in our lives. So let's boot them out of the schools. Let's boot them out of our homes. Let's boot them out of all these places. And then when chaos ensues, what's the first thing we do? Why is God allowing this to happen? Even atheists will do that. Well, if there's a God, why do all these things happen? These things are happening because of the darkness in people's hearts. and the wickedness in people's hearts, right? The Bible says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But when we come into Christ, we are renewed as new creations. We are renewed in our promises. We are renewed in our covenant with God. So what we're seeing in our society is a several things that are taking place. We have the world system working, which is the Antichrist system, and that's in the earth today. The Antichrist spirit is in the earth today, and there's chaos, and there's rebellion, and there's all these things, right? Sometimes I don't like when I hear people's, good morning, Apostle Rosita. You can unmute if you want so we can hear your wonderful voice.
Just say we can't hear you.
Unmute. Praise God. Hallelujah. Woo!
Can somebody text her?
Yeah, so you're still on mute.
You should make signs, Gabby. Unmute.
Put a zipper across.
Yeah, it. Unmuted. Okay,
there we go.
Okay.
Very apostolic this morning.
Oh, love you guys. Look, I said I'm going to try to follow you in my car. I'm in the house while we're getting ready for church, but I'm going to try to stick with you.
Okay.
Well, okay, love you all.
Right now, I'm reading from Psalms 10, but okay. We're also going to be reading from 1 Samuel chapter 3 as well. That's kind of the part of my message. But one of the things I'll try to capsulize what I have been saying is Psalms 10 is about God's triumph over evil. And we see that there's a lot of evil things that are taking place in the earth. And the Bible does even tell us that evil will thrive in the earth. And evil men will thrive, but God will have the final say in the end, right?
Amen.
God will have
God
will triumph over evil. And we also said, well, if you know, many people say, well, if God is such a loving God, why is all this happening in the earth? Well, my response is because we reject God. We rejected him. We said, we don't need you in the schools. We don't need you in the homes. We don't need you in any place. Leave us to ourselves. Yeah. Guess what? When we're left to ourselves, this is what takes place.
Amen. Yes.
When we're left to ourselves and we don't have a compass and we don't have the Spirit of God. That's why when we're born again, the Bible says he quickens us. He's taken us from death unto life, right? Yeah. And we're renewed in our covenant. We're new creations according to 2 Corinthians 5:17. If a man or if anyone be born again,
yes,
he is a creation. Old things pass away. Behold, all things are made new. So he's brought back sonship. He's renewed our sonship. He's renewed our covenant with him. And now it is time for the body of Christ to rise up because God has given to the church to be the voice in the earth. And that's why he's restoring the apostolic and the prophetic. Because in the New Testament, apostles govern. And we need to start learning how to govern.
In the
Old Testament, the prophets were the ones who were the spokesmen for God. But now the apostles have that authority and they have prophets alongside with them. Because according to the Bible, right, the apostles and the prophets are the foundation.
Yes.
The foundation. And so God is restoring and renewing that. And something I said last week, that the enemy is stirring. We talked about the wiles of the devil, meaning he's methodical. He's very methodical and slow about the things he does. He wants you to be lazy. He wants you to not be thinking about anything so that he can come in and take hold. He goes about like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And if we're not paying attention, we can end up being devoured. So this psalm is a song of triumph. And when we read in verse 1, it says, why do you stand afar? And now it does seem like God's afar off. He's like, God, why is all this stuff happening?
Mm-hmm.
hide in times of trouble. And many people think that way, that God is hiding in times of trouble. He must be hiding from all this. But let me say this, this has not taken God by surprise.
Amen. Amen.
Taken him by surprise. As a matter of fact, he might be up in, he might be on the throne laughing. We did say the Bible sits there and laughs at the plots and plans of men. Don't he? He laughs.
Yeah.
But it says the wicked in his pride persecutes the poor. Let them be caught in the plots which they have devised. There's a there's plots being taking place in our world today.
Yes, it is.
Taking place. These are the plots of men. These are the plots of evil men trying to divide and cause chaos, right? Because our battle, our wrestle is not with flesh and blood, but with principalities, powers in the air, right? How many know that Satan is not in the in the ground ruling? He's in the air. He's the principality of the air.
Yes.
He's in the second heaven. He's in the second realm. That's why he's in the airwaves. He's in the media. Hello, are you with me? So these types of things, so he is ruling in the second heaven. But you and I rule in the third heaven, far above these things, far above principalities. But he goes on to say, for the wicked boast of his heart's desires. The wicked are boasting right now. They're boasting. He blesses the greedy and renounces the Lord. There it is. The wicked in his proud countenance does not seek God. You see, none of them are seeking God. God is in none of their thoughts. The wicked mind has no intentions of thinking about the things of God. The wicked heart and the wicked mind does not seek God. It says, your judgments, his ways are always prospering. Your judgments are far above, out of his sight. As for all his enemies, he sneers at them. He has said in his heart, I shall not be moved. I shall never be in adversity. His mouth is full of cursing and deceit. There's a deception going on in the earth. There is an absolute deception. People are being deceived. You see, if you know, if you take the sheepdog away, the wolf is going to come and play. Do you understand? And I believe we're the sheepdog. We're the ones protecting the earth. We're the church. And if you take the sheepdog, that's why you hear some of them want to get rid of the police department. Well, my goodness, if that takes place, guess what? All hell is going to break loose. You're not safe. You know, there's always some bad apples in the bunch, but you can't throw away the bunch. You can't throw away everything because of a few bad apples. There's always been some bad apples in the church, but we didn't throw the church away, did we? We still meet in the churches, don't we? Because of some bad apples in the church, we're still meeting, we're still preaching, we're still doing those things. But see, they, you know, so you got to be careful of the things that we desire, because sometimes God in his mercy gives us what we desire. And we have to be careful that we don't desire a lawless society. Because if we desire a lawless society, we're in trouble. We're going to go back to the old West, where people are going to carry guns on their side. That's what's going to happen. So we have to be careful of the things that we desire on the earth. He has said in his heart, I shall not be moved. In his mouth is full of cursing, deceit, and oppression. Under his tongue is trouble and iniquity. He sits in the lurking places of the villages. In the secret place, he murders the innocent. That's what wicked people do. They lurk. And you don't have to strangle somebody physically to kill somebody. Hello? My goodness. You don't have to be physically strangling somebody to kill somebody. You can kill somebody already in your heart. Jesus says, if you hate your brother, you've already committed murder. Just like Jesus said, listen, if you lust after another woman, you've committed adultery. Mm-hmm. If you lust after another woman, or women, if you lust after another man, you've committed adultery. So, you know, grace is a higher standard. We thought the law is a standard, but grace is a higher standard because we didn't deserve grace. It was bestowed on us, so it's a higher standard to live by. That's why we need the Holy Spirit. That's why we need to renew our mind. That's why we have to commit ourselves to prayer and the reading of the word. Let's continue. But the wicked, they plot and they secretly plot. And you can plot secretly against your brother even though you don't physically touch him. You could destroy with your words. His eyes are secretly fixed on the helpless. He lies in wait secretly as a lion in his den. He lies in wait to catch the poor. He catches the poor when he draws him into his net. Verse 10. So he crouches, he lies low, just like we talked about the alligator. The alligator sits and lurks down real low and streams about the waters, that the helpless may fall by his strength. He has said in his heart, God has forgotten. He hides his face, he will never see. Arise, O Lord. Lift up your hand. Do not forget the humble. How many know God gives grace to the humble? Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. God gives grace to the humble. Why do the wicked renounce God? He has said in his heart, you will not require an account. We will have to give an account for the things we've done on this earth, both unbeliever and believer. Hello, are you with me? Both believer and unbeliever will give an account of the things we've done on the earth. Okay? So whatever God has given us, whatever stewardship God has given us, we're going to have to give an account, right? Listen, we read these in the parables. If I invest money, I want to see the results of the money that I invested, right? When I give somebody money to invest in a business or invest in something, and they come back to me and say, well, I didn't really do anything with it, I'm going to be mad. They squandered and wasted my money. And we can't squander and waste the gift of God that's been given to us. Amen? So it says in verse 14, but God has seen. God sees all that's taking place. For you observe trouble and grief. To repay it by your hand, the helpless commits himself to you. You are the helper of the fatherless. There's a culture that has no fathers in the homes. And I'm sorry to say this, and I thank God for all the single ladies that have to raise their child. The fathers are to lead their homes. That's how God planned it. And there's a whole generation that are fatherless. And it's mostly, and I say this with compassion, it's mostly in the African-American community where they're fatherless. Because government wants to say, we'll take care of you. I've heard stories that when a social worker would come to a house, they would tell the father, get out of the house so that they don't see that there's a man in the home. Because government wants to be their daddy, right? But fathers, take up your mantle. Take up your mantle. In spite of what the world is saying, the world will sit there and say, Lynette and I will be going on 29 years together. The world says, that's crazy. You'd be with somebody that long. But see, I live by this standard. I live because my rewards are eternal. So it says, let me go to verse 15. Break the arm of the wicked and the evil man. seek out his wickedness until you find none. The Lord is king. Hallelujah. Forever and ever. The Lord is king forever and ever. Presidents will come and go, but the Lord is king forever. The nations have perished out of his land. Lord, you have heard the desire of the humble. God gives grace to the humble. You will prepare their heart. You will cause your ear to hear, to do justice to the fatherless and the oppressed, that the man on the earth may oppress no more. And there's going to come a day when the oppressions of men will cease, because we'll be under the rule of Almighty God. Hallelujah. Thank God. We look forward to that day, for his kingdom come, his will be done. We will not see brother rise against brother, nations rise against nations, but we'll live in peace with one another because God will be our authority. There's not even going to be need for sunlight anymore because the glory, hey, Shakurabase, the glory of the Lord will flood the earth. The glory of the Lord will shine. We won't need light anymore because the glory of the Lord will shine on us. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, because darkness is going to be dispelled. And the enemy, the devil understands his outcome. The devil understands he only has a limited amount of time. So he has to do what he has to do to take every individual he can to help. Can I say this? That hell is eternal just as much as heaven is? It's eternal. To be separated from God forever, where you'll be praying, but no one will hear you. There'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth, and God will not respond. Oh, my goodness. I could not be in that place in total darkness, yelling out for God, and God will not respond to me, because we had our chance here, right? It's appointed for men to die once, then to judgment. Hallelujah. Once, then to judgment. So you hear, if you hear the voice of the Lord today and you need Jesus Christ as your Savior today, today is your salvation. Today, don't reject God's plan, because God wants has a plan for you, and not only to fulfill his purpose on earth, but he wants you to be with him forever in eternity. Hallelujah. Glory to God, where there's going to be no sin, no death, no sickness, no disease. So today, if anybody tunes in later on today, accept Christ as your Savior now. Tonight, today is the day of your salvation. Be washed in the blood of the Lamb. That's the only way. Through the blood of Jesus. God's salvation, God's gift of eternal life is through Jesus Christ, our Lord. So I pray that today. So Father, we're going to just go into a time of worship. Father, in the name of Jesus, bless this worship time. Lord, prepare us to receive the word. We already got a mouthful already. But Lord, I pray that we exalt the name of the Lord here right now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find to bless the Lord, oh my soul. His holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Bless you, strength is failing, the end draws near, and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Come on, bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy. Worship your holy name, Lord, I worship your holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Jesus, I will worship your holy name. Worship your holy name.
Just worship the Lord right now. Just give him thanks and praise. And I just want to stay in this time of worship. Did you want to bring anything for offering? Okay. So Pastor Ryan's just going to come and say a few things, and we'll get into the Word of God. Amen.
Amen. Hey. How's everyone doing?
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. You know, Apostle said earlier about not squandering your what the Lord gives you, not squandering anything he gives you. And that includes when it comes to any monetary amount as well, any riches, if you will. You know, in 1 Timothy 6:17 says, command those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty, nor to trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God, who gives us richly all things to enjoy. Let them do good, that they be rich in good works, ready to receive, willing to share, storing up for themselves a good foundation for the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. You know, we're not supposed to put any trust in the earthly riches of this world, because we're not of this world. Like you said, you're supposed to put the trust into the one true almighty God, into the giving of eternal life. So when it comes to the riches, don't put your trust or any of that into the riches, but into God himself. But we can use those riches, like Apostle said earlier, about not squandering them. If the Lord so blesses you with these riches and things like that, you should be able to use them to further the kingdom of God. And one way that we do that is by bringing in the tithe. You know, and that's where we always go to with Malachi. It says, bring all that tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Now try me in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, so that he will not destroy the fruit of your ground, nor shall the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field. You know, he will rebuke that devourer for our sakes, whatever that devourer may be, whatever the enemy is trying to put a stranglehold on you with, that is what he will rebuke. And I thank you for that. So with that being said, let us bring that tithe into the storehouse so that there may be food in the Lord's house. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you.
So now let us just put that up in front of the great high priest. Father, I thank you for all that you have done, all that you will do, all that you are continuing to do in all of our lives. We bring this to you today, Father, so that not our will, but your will be done, so that there may be food in your house, to store your house. And in Jesus' mighty name, I thank you, Father, for rebuking that devourer. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Pastor Ryan. And so open up your Bibles to 1 Samuel chapter 3. And I felt the Lord bring this to me again. It's something that I ministered some time ago, but I felt the Lord pressing on me to go to this again in 1 Samuel chapter 3. And we're going to read verses 1 through 11. And revelation, the self-unveiling to humanity of the God who cannot be discovered by humanity simply through his own efforts, uncovering or bringing to light. Revelation is a manifestation, or to be revealed. So I want to go to 1 Samuel chapter 3, and it talks about Samuel's calling when Samuel was a little boy. Because it says in verse 1 of chapter 3, it says, now the boy, Samuel, he was a boy. Some scholars say he was probably of 8 to 10 years old. And it says, minister to the Lord before Eli. And I want you to underline that, because you're going to see something later in the passage that I really want you to see. But it says, he ministered to the Lord before Eli. And the word of the Lord was rare in those days. There was no widespread revelation. You know, there's a lot of people today that are bringing preaching, teaching, but there is no revelation to it. And that word rare means, I want to show you what it means in the Hebrew. It means precious. It means highly valued. It means weight. You see, there's a lot of preaching, but there's no weight to the preaching. There's a lot of preaching, and there's a lot of teaching, and there's a lot of releasing of a word. I mean, every time you turn on Facebook, somebody got a word, but there's no weight to it. There's no revelation to it. It's just us wanting to be in front of the camera saying, look what I can give you. When you think of Jonah, Jonah brought a word to Nineveh and the whole entire city repented. But yet you have mega churches, you have all these places all over the place, and yet their cities are still riddled with crime and there's a decline in their society. Because the revelation that's being brought forth, it has no weight to it. The word that's being preached has no weight to it. There's no anointing on it. It said it was rare, and it means precious. You know, when you find something rare, what do you do with it? Like, if you find a rare jewel, what do you do with it? You hold it with great value, don't you? Man, I found this jewel. I found this thing's worth thousands of dollars. You're not just going to let it lay around, are you? Where other people can take it. You're not going to let it lay around for other people to see it. You're not going to let it. You hold it close to you. So when it says the word of the Lord was rare, it was rare and it was precious because it wasn't being brought forth. So when the word of the Lord came, it was precious. It was valued. It had weight to it. It was rare in those days. It was rare to see true revelation being brought forth in the earth. We need true revelation. And you're going to see in this chapter that the revelation that we need is Jesus Christ. We need a revelation of Jesus again. We need a renewed revelation. When you go to the end of the book, it doesn't say revelations. It says the revelation of Jesus Christ. He is the revelation of God. He is the manifestation of God. He is the image of the invincible God. He is. And the earth needs a revelation again. The church, the ecclesia, needs a revelation of who Jesus is again. We've diminished him. We've lowered him. But the Bible says we must exalt him. We must put his name above all other names. The Bible says that. His name is the name above all names. Every name. And at that name, every knee should bow. And every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord of all. He's Lord of all. You see, it was rare. The word there means davar, means speech, acts, utterance, a sound, a declaration. Our declarations have no weight to it. Our declarations have no sound to it. Our declarations need the sound of heaven. And that's what's happening. It's the word of the Lord is rare, and there's a lot of chattering. There's a lot of releasing. There's a lot of this and a lot of that. But it's not precious. People are not holding it with great value. So when we bring the word, and it says there acts, the word has a meaning. There needs to be action behind our words. The word of the Lord was rare. It was rare. Let me just continue. And there was no widespread revelation. And it came to pass at that time, while Eli was laying down in his place, when his eyes had begun to grow so dim. My goodness, our eyes are growing dim, aren't they? Our eyes have been growing dim. Our spiritual eyes have been growing dim. We're not seeing anymore. Where are the true seers? Where are the true seers that see the things of what's happening in the earth? But they're growing dim. It says Eli was lying down. That's what the church is doing. It's lying down. God had to bring judgment. God had to bring judgment to Eli. Because his sons were lazy. His sons defiled the temple. Eli was lying down and his eyes were growing dim. He couldn't see anymore. And that's what's happening to us. To grow so dim that he could not see. The Bible said it grew so dim he couldn't see. And that's what's happening. Our eyes are growing dim. We can't see. Jesus said that the cares of this world will choke you out. We can't see anymore because we're worried about this and that. And God says, keep your eyes on me. Keep your eyes on me. If you're a business owner, keep your eyes on God. He'll show you how to run your business. Right? So listen. It says Eli was lying down in his place, and when his eyes had begun to grow so dim that he could not see, and before the lamp of God went out in the tabernacle of the Lord, where the ark of God was, and while Samuel was lying down, you and I are the tabernacle of the Lord now. And the lamp of the tabernacle went out on Eli. Eli's lamp went out. He let his light go out. His eyes, he couldn't see no more because of complacency and laziness. Or where is God? Oh, I'm just going to live this way. And then when I go to church, I'll live that way. His eyes grew dim. He couldn't see no more. And when you don't have sight, you don't have vision. And when you don't have vision, the people perish. The word of the Lord was rare, and there was no widespread revelation because the vision, there is no vision. And without vision, the people perish. This is built up in me. I know the Lord wants me to preach this message because I'm speaking to the church. I'm speaking to the ecclesia. People are perishing because our eyes and lights have gone out. And we need God to stir our hearts again. We need to reignite it again. And thank God in his mercy, he'll do that. Because in the book of Haggai, it says that he stirred the heart of Zerubbabel. He stirred the hearts of the people. And we need God to stir our hearts again in the name of Jesus. Listen. We need the word of God to break out violently. And I mean that in the biblical sense. Let me tell you something. If you don't think the enemy doesn't fight violently, he does. And we need to go at them violently with the word of God. Hallelujah. That's our sword. It says it's the sword of the Spirit. You don't keep your sword in your pouch. You got to use it when the enemy comes. When the enemy's coming after your children. When the enemy's coming after your grandchildren. You got to go violently at them with the word of God. Come on. Come on, if you come past my threshold unwelcomed, I'm going to come at you with the sword.
Amen.
Hallelujah. The word of the Lord. Hallelujah. It said, listen. It said the lamp had died out. And the Bible says that the word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. If that lamp goes out, you're going to wander in the wilderness. You're going to wander in darkness. You're going to forget where a path you were on. And Eli's eyes went dim. He had no vision. His lamp went out because he said it was in the tabernacle. You and I are the tabernacle. You and I is where God dwells. We are the ark of the covenant now where God dwells. Hallelujah. We're the ark. Glory to God. So it says that Lord, he says, and while Samuel was lying down, that the Lord called Samuel. And he answered, here am I. So he ran to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. And he said, I did not call. Lie down again. And he went and lied down again. Then the Lord called yet again Samuel. So Samuel rose and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." He answered, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not. Now here again, it said that Samuel ministered to before the Lord with Eli. Here it says that Samuel did not know the Lord, nor was the word of the Lord yet revealed to him. How many of us are ministering before the Lord, and yet the word of God has not been revealed or manifested in our lives? How many of us are ministering unto the Lord and yet had no revelation of God? It said Samuel did not know the Lord yet, but yet he was ministering unto the Lord. That's what's happening. We got people ministering and didn't even have an encounter or a manifestation of God yet in their lives. Mm-hmm. When Jesus came into the room, Thomas had a revelation. He was a disciple of the Lord, but until when he touched him, touched his side, touched his wound, he had a revelation. When Paul on the road to Damascus, he was a scholar. He was a Hebrew of Hebrews. He knew the law. But until he encountered Jesus on the road to Damascus, he had a revelation of who Jesus was. We're preaching and teaching and got no revelation of who Jesus is. We just want to preach and teach and hear ourselves. Hallelujah. Is that right? Yeah. Thomas had to touch his side. And he wasn't doubting no more. That's where we get doubting Thomas, right? Because he was doubting the Lord. Peter said, Jesus said, "Who do you say that I am?" He said, "You are the Christ. You are the Christ." And he said, "Flesh and blood didn't reveal that to you, but by my Father in heaven." Nathanael went to Peter. To Philip. Was it Nathanael went to Philip? Or the other way around? Let's go there for a sec. I want you to go to there. Go to John chapter 1. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Are you with me today?
Yes.
Hallelujah. In 47 of chapter 1 of John, Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said of him, "Behold, an Israelite, indeed, in whom is no deceit." Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" Jesus answered and said to him, "Before Philip called you," because when Philip found out, when Philip got a revelation, he had to go tell someone. "To call you when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Nathanael answered and said to him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Listen, Nathanael got a revelation. He said, "Before I knew you, I saw you under the fig tree." We need a revelation again. Let's continue on. It said, "Now Samuel did not know the Lord, nor was the word of the Lord yet revealed to him." It was not revealed to him. Hallelujah. And that word really means to present himself. God did not present himself to Samuel yet. And we have to understand, before we go and preach the word of God, God needs to present himself to us. Samuel ministered unto the Lord, but then it says he knew not the Lord. But they said the Lord, it was not revealed to him. Let me continue on to verse 8. "And the Lord called Samuel again the third time. So he arose and went to Eli and said, 'Here I am, for you did call me.' Then Eli perceived that the Lord had called the boy." We see a lot of times when we get a revelation or we get a word of the Lord, we run into man all the time. We're always running to men and we're not running to God. When we get a word, we run. And see here, God revealed himself. Tim, now here's what I want you to see. In verse 10, let me go back to verse 9 again. Therefore, Eli said to Samuel, go lie down, and it shall be, if he calls you, that you must say, speak, Lord, for your servant hears. So Samuel went and laid down in his place. How many know that we need these types of people in our lives, that when you come and say, I think I'm hearing from the Lord, that you get the right instruction, that you get the right counsel, right? And that we don't rely on man all the time, that we're relying solely on God and the word that he revealed to us. We need these types of people that can say, what Eli said to Samuel, go lie down and it shall be, if he calls you, you must say, speak. You must say, speak. For your servant hears. So Samuel went and laid down in his place. And in verse 11, it said, in verse 10, it says, now the Lord came and stood. So first we have the word coming to him, but here we see the Lord stood. The Lord came and stood. He had to unveil himself and reveal himself to Samuel. It said the Lord came and stood and spoke to Samuel. Samuel got a revelation of the Lord himself. Not just by what men are saying, but Samuel got a revelation of God because it said the Lord stood before Samuel. Hallelujah. Now the Lord came and stood and called as at other times, Samuel, Samuel. Behold, he stood before him. He got a revelation of Jesus. Come on now. He had unveiled himself to Samuel. Nothing will start changing until Christ is unveiled in your life and revealed in your life. The truth of who he is, not coming to church to hear about him, not just to come to church to hear about Jesus. You need an encounter with Jesus. And that word revealed also means, I'm going to tell you what it says, the word of the Lord has not been revealed to him yet. The word revealed means the word of the Lord has not stripped Samuel of who Samuel is, that the life of Christ may live in him. It also gives us an understanding that he had to take them captive. The Bible says that the Lord Jesus himself has taken men captive and given them gifts. It's until the Lord strips you of who you are and then takes you captive and gives a revelation of who you are that things are going to start changing in your life. You see, that word reveal, Samuel had to be stripped. See, that nothing of you must live. Everything of you must die. And Christ in me, the hope of glory, must live in me. It is not I who live, but Christ who now lives in me. Man, when you get that revelation and you start to proclaim and start preaching the word and start giving around, there's going to be weightiness behind it now. There's going to be weight and there's going to be an anointing behind it. Because a lot of times we want to get out there and we want to preach just so that we can be known unto men. We want to preach. How many know if God said to you, go into obscurity because your voice will be more powerful in your obscurity? How many would do it? How many would do it if God said, I want you to be obscure? I want you to be unknown because your voice will be more powerful. I bet you 3/4 of people will reject that because we want to be in front of everything. How many want to be? I want to be obscure. So that my voice may be more powerful. That's what God told me. After a while, you get tired of being out in front. After a while, that's okay. I really appreciate my wife. I start to get the revelation from my wife. Being behind the scenes is just as good as being out in front. But let me tell you something. That word revealed gives us the understanding that there had to be a stripping. There had to be, Samuel had to be taken captive by the Lord himself. And so many of us are not being taken captive by the captain of our salvation. He took men captive and gave them gifts. Hallelujah. It's not about hearing about him. It's about knowing who he is in your life. It's about knowing who he is, not just simply hearing. Again, the word revealed means to, it actually means to denude, believe it or not. Right? Be denude. How many have been in a place of vulnerability where you just feel like you've been stripped? And sometimes that stripping away needs to happen because all that stuff. Hallelujah. God needs to disclose some things about you in order for you to get on your way. God needs to strip you of your attitude, of your pride. God needs to strip you of, oh, I don't need God. Or I don't need to be around God's people to know God. How many know that God wants us to be around each other? It's God how planned it. A plant doesn't grow just simply by watering. And a lot of people, that's why a lot of people talk to their plants. You know that? The crazy people do, I guess, anyway. I'm 50 years old now. I gave my mom a plant when I was 17. She still has that plant.
Wow.
It's a spider plant. Still has it. It's in her house. Right? And it's producing, it produces babies. She's been giving out. That's what we need to do is produce sons and daughters. But listen, we need God to strip us of pride, of prejudice, of racism. Let me tell you something. Let's not think the church is innocent of racism. Sometimes it's the most segregated place in America on Sundays. Right? All the white people flood to the white churches. All the African-American people flood to the African-American churches. And we praise God. I think something's shifting in the atmosphere, and I think the people of God, the apostolic is arising to call for, because there's an apostolic arising, but there is no weight behind the revelation. Some of them pander. Instead of bringing truth, they pander to each side. They take a side because that might benefit them if they take a side. Are you with me today? And we can't have that today. The truth of God's word is going to be revealed, and it's going to be weighty. I don't know, Rosita, I don't know if Apostle Darrell is with you right now, but I prophesied over him that he is going to have the apostolic voice in his region. And when he brings forth the word of the Lord, there's going to be great revelation, and it's going to have such great weight to it. How many know we need the weightiness of God, right? We talked about the kabod, glory of God, and that weight that comes forth from that revelation from him is going to be weighty. I speak that over his life.
Yes, sir.
I prophesy that over
yes,
his
sir. Life. Yes, sir. I'll make sure I let him know that.
To raise him up as an apostolic voice, and there's apostles that are going to join with him, I believe, including me, that are going to be a voice.
Yes, sir. Oh, yeah. Yes, Lord.
Truth.
Yes. Yes.
We're going to break down these walls, but God's got to strip us first.
Yeah.
He's got to take us captive first.
Glory. Glory,
yes. It said Samuel ministered before the Lord with Eli, but then it said Samuel didn't know the Lord yet. The word of the Lord was not revealed to him, meaning Samuel had to get denuded. He had to get stripped of all things so that Christ can truly work in him. Hallelujah. Father, how many received this word today?
Amen.
Woo. Amen. Behold, I will do something in Israel. This is, listen, in 3:11. Then the Lord said to Samuel, behold, I will do something in Israel at which both ears of everyone who hears it will tingle. I believe the word of the Lord is coming to America, that all the ears that hear it are going to start to tingle, and it's going to start to shake, because the Spirit of the Lord says in the last days, the Spirit expressly says that certain things are going to come upon the earth. And the word of the Lord, listen, the word of the Lord is coming to America, and all the ears that hear it will tingle. It's going to bring us back again. God is using whatever. Listen, how many know God will take what the enemy's doing and turn around for his purpose? And I'm going to tell you something. Whatever's what's going on with COVID and what's going on with the racism and all the upheaval, God is going to use it to bring his church back. It's going to strip us of everything. It's going to strip us of everything. Because when we come forth stripped of ourselves, the revelation's going to be weighty, and the ears that hear are going to tingle. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for today. We thank you for the word of the Lord. We thank you for the examples that are given in the word. And, Father, I pray, I stand as an overseer and as an apostle of the Lord, I come to you today, Father, and I say, forgive me where I have fallen short. Forgive me if I've become lazy, or I've let my eyes go dim, or I've let the lamp go out in my tabernacle. Father, revive us again. Stir the hearts of your people again. As I stand as a leader and overseer, oh, Lord, do it again in America, that the revelation will have weight, and the word of the Lord will be precious and highly valued. God will triumph over his enemies. God will triumph over evil. I believe God is using the evil things to tear down itself. We're seeing it down in these cities. So, Father, I stand as an example. Lord, I pray, let the streams of refreshing come again. Let the streams of refreshing flood the East Coast. Let the fire of God consume everything that's not of you, that we may be truly found in you. Father, you gave us gifts to be stewards of it in this dispensation. May we not waste those things in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. If you give God, if you agree, just give God a shout of praise. Hallelujah. Hey, Lord, thank you, Lord. We just agree with that word that you've given us, Father.
Amen.
And I just thank God that he's given me the strength to bring that. And I just thank the Lord.
Amen.
And the Apostle Daryl that's there. And
yes, Lord, thank you.
And for all those that are here at Ryan's Hem, there's Elder Steve. So we just thank God for this word of the Lord. I hope it's encouraged you. Rosita, I know you've got to be somewhere, so if you got to go, we release you and bless your day. If you have any final thoughts, go ahead. Guess you froze up.
She's taking a chill.
We know you got a word to release us. You could send it to me on the inbox. Whatever God has spoke to you. Yeah. So we thank you, Lord.
Hey.
Father, we come. Yes. Okay. So, Father, thank you for today. We bless you today. We thank Dina for her willingness to stay home so that we can have a good sounding worship. And we appreciate that, Dina, your sacrifice there. And I thank you, Lord. I don't know. I'm renewed.
Amen.
I'm stirred again.
Yes.
Amen. And then he tried to take us out, didn't he? God had to strip us.
Yes.
He had to strip us. So, Lord, thank you for the denuding. We think of that word like, ooh, that's... But God has to denude us, right? Because when we come before the Lord, we're going to be bare before him anyway. There's nothing we can bring. We can't say, Lord, let me give you that final offering so I can get into heaven. The only thing God's going to see is the blood of Jesus. Is the blood of Jesus on you. So, Lord, I thank you for the blood of Jesus. I thank you for every person here today that's given to the ministry that we can go into the nation. And we thank you for that, Lord. Bless everyone in this house. And Father, we thank you for your goodness and your kindness towards us, Father God. You've taken us captive and given us gifts. We're blessed. We're blessed amongst all people. What did Ishtiak call the word of the Lord from Ishtiak was, we are the ancient people. We proclaim the end from the beginning. See, we can't, that's a hard thing to fathom, but I'm getting it. So, Lord, thank you for the word of the Lord today. In Jesus' name. Amen. Bless you all, and we'll see you soon.
Hey.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.